In the 1980s, the machine learning revolution took the world by storm. Tasks such as detecting credit card fraud, pricing insurance plans, and recommending shopping items were beginning to be automated. Machine learning models, trained on huge amounts of historical data, were able to automatically perform these tasks. In addition, they often did a better job than the human experts that were previously responsible for them. Following these successes, researchers all over the world raced to apply machine learning to solve more and more problems. But there was one thing that machine learning simply could not do, and that was to see. More precisely, the task of image recognition is to decide which out of a handful of categories of object is present in an image. Every single attempt to train machines to automatically recognize images was met with failure. It didn't matter which type of model was used, even the deepest of neural networks were incapable of matching human performance. So why is it that machine learning models, which can perform all of these other tasks at a superhuman level, struggle so badly when it comes to images? All machine learning models do the same thing, curve fitting. Given a collection of points, the model will attempt to find a function which passes as close to them as possible. This is useful because pretty much any task can be represented as a curve fitting exercise. For example, suppose that we want to create a model that can tell apart cats from dogs. If we have an image, along with its correct label, we can represent the fact that this image has this label by plotting a point on these axes. The x-coordinate describes the image, and the y-coordinate its label, -1 for dog and +1 for cat. We can add another point into our plot for each labeled image that we have. And then we can fit a function through them. Now we can simply evaluate this function on a new image to get an automatic prediction of whether or not a human would classify this image as a cat or a dog. In this case, the function value is greater than 0, so this image is automatically classified as a cat. Now, clearly, the function that we fit is not going to exactly equal the true labels that we would get by having a human label every possible input. In particular, if the point we evaluate the function at is far away from the labeled points we use to fit the function, then there's a good chance our predicted label will be different to the true label. But if we have enough labeled points spread densely throughout the input space, then we can be confident that our predictions will be close to the true labels everywhere. This would all be well and good if it weren't for one small problem. We can't actually describe an image with a single number. In order to describe a single pixel, we would need to use three numbers for the red, green, and blue intensities of that pixel. And of course, we need to describe every pixel in the image. So if we want to represent this image with a single point, then it needs to be a high-dimensional point, where the coordinate along each dimension describes a particular pixel intensity. Here is what curve fitting looks like with two-dimensional inputs. As you can see, it is mostly the same as the one-dimensional case, but if you look closely, you'll notice that our 9 labeled points actually cover much less space. I mean, just look at how much distance there is between them. And that's because before, we only needed to fill one dimension, so we could put all 9 of our points onto this one line. But now we need to spread the points out over two dimensions. In order to fill the 2D space to the same density, we would actually need to label 9 times as many points. And this only gets worse in higher dimensions. Each new dimension, we need 9 times as many points as the previous. In general, we need 9 to the power of n points to densely fill n dimensions. Even if we use very tiny images, just 32 by 32 pixels, it still takes 3072 numbers to describe each image. The input space of all 32 by 32 images is 3072 dimensional, and in order to densely fill that space, you would need to label around about 9 to the power of 3072 images, which is significantly larger than the number of particles in the universe. And by the way, We've so far only been classifying between two classes, which means we only need to output one number. But we can classify any number of classes by simply having the model output one number for each class, then the output will be multidimensional as well. So when we talk about training a machine learning model on high-dimensional data, this is actually quite misleading. Instead, you should picture something more like this. Because no matter how many labeled points you gather, you will never fill more than the tiniest portion of the input space. Of course, we can still fit a function through the labeled points, but chances are it's going to be wildly inaccurate when evaluated on new points. And this is what sets image recognition apart from all those other tasks. It's possible to accurately price a person's insurance premium just by knowing a handful of features about that person. The neural network only needs to look at a small number of values, so the space of possible inputs is low dimensional. Images, however, are high dimensional. Very, very high dimensional. This is why, when you train a deep neural network on the Cypher 10 dataset, a collection of 50,000 32 by 32 images, each belonging to one of 10 different categories, it will only achieve 74.3% test accuracy, while humans can easily achieve 99.5% accuracy. So how do you train a neural network on high-dimensional inputs? Well, that's the neat part. You don't. Instead of using the whole image, if we only allow the neural network to look at a small part, say this 3x3 patch of pixels, and ignore everything else, well, we now have low-dimensional input. And we can easily train a neural network on low-dimensional inputs. Problem solved. Well, not quite. Since we're now only looking at this 3x3 patch, if the object of interest is not within this patch, then clearly the model won't be able to correctly predict the label. We can just apply the model to every single 3x3 patch in the image, and average the predictions from each. This way we'll get the best prediction possible from any single patch. But even then, there often won't be any single patch which contains enough information by itself to decide what the object is. Usually, it will be necessary to see at least a few different patches at the same time. It might even be necessary to look at the entire image. So, whilst our neural network can easily learn any function from 3x3 patches as inputs, there is no function which accurately maps 3x3 patches to object labels. On the other hand, if we use the entire image as input, then it will be impossible to learn. And the solution to this seemingly impossible conundrum is to do it again. We can apply the neural network to every patch, and then we can apply another neural network to patches of the first neural network's output. Since every output was made from a 3x3 patch of pixels, and we are now looking at a 3x3 patch of outputs, the second neural network is effectively looking at a 5x5 patch of pixels. And we can do this as many times as we like. In each successive layer, the next neural network can look at larger and larger regions of the original input. If we do this enough times, the final neural network will be able to look at the entire image. We can then simply average the outputs from the final neural network to get the final prediction. And this is known as a convolutional neural network. All of the layers are trained together at the same time so that the final layer's output becomes closer to the true labels. Note that this means that earlier layers are no longer predicting the object directly, rather they will just learn to output a bunch of numbers which are useful for the next layers. And when this model is trained on the Cypher 10 dataset, it achieves 95.3% accuracy. Not a bad improvement for simply restricting each layer's field of view. But hold on a minute, if the final layer is effectively looking at the entire image, then isn't it a high-dimensional function, and hence impossible to train? Well, suppose that each layer outputs three numbers. Since the input to the first layer is a 3x3 patch of pixels, that is 27 numbers, and this layer outputs just three numbers, the output must lose some information about the input. So whilst the second layer's output can contain information from anywhere in this 5x5 region, it will not contain all of the information in this 5x5 region. Only a small amount of information can get through the first layer. And this is true for every layer. Each layer is forced to compress its input patches into just three numbers, ensuring that the input dimension to any layer is always 27. So every layer has a low-dimensional input, and hence the entire model can be easily trained with just tens of thousands of labeled examples. Now, there is one more little thing that I should probably mention. In the convolutional neural network I just described, each layer output three numbers. This is what kept the dimension low. However, in practice, it's more common for them to output hundreds or even thousands of numbers. And that means that the layers are not forced to compress their inputs. It turns out, though, that even if the layers aren't forced to compress their inputs, they will end up doing so anyway. And the reason for this is the way that neural networks are trained. Neural networks start with small random weights and then learn by making small changes to each weight in order to make predictions closer to labels. So, to start off with, all of the output numbers will be completely random, containing no information from the input. As training progresses, one by one, they will learn to capture some useful information about the input. Once enough information passes through this layer to solve the task, the weights will stop being updated, and all of the remaining outputs will be left as random. Crucially, the random values will be ignored by the next layer. So, even if the layer outputs 1,000 numbers, the vast majority of them are actually useless, and the output really does only contain a small amount of task-relevant information. In practice, this means convolutional layers are easy to train no matter how many numbers they output. In fact, if anything, they actually get easier to train the more outputs they have. The more random weights we start with, the more likely it is that some of them will start off close to useful values. This is the reason why we usually give neural network layers so many outputs. It should be noted, though, that once a neural network has been completely trained, you can remove more than 90% of the weights from the model without changing its performance at all. Now, to be clear, this only works because we are training on natural images. It tends to be the case that when you go outside in the real world and you take photos of real things, nearby pixels will be part of the same object. And so you can take a patch of nearby pixels and describe it in a simple way, such as, "This is grass texture." That is to say, patches of nearby pixels are highly compressible. And that's why it's possible for our convolutional neural network layers to keep their outputs effectively low-dimensional while still passing useful information to the next layer. We have designed the convolutional architecture to exploit the spatial structure present in the real world. However, if our data did not have this structure, for example, if we were to randomly reorder the pixels in our images, well, now nearby pixels actually come from different parts of the image, and these pixels have no relationship to each other. This patch is now a bunch of uncorrelated random values, and it cannot easily be described other than to just write down all of the pixel values. And a convolutional layer will not be able to compress this patch without losing useful information. Thus, when we train a convolutional neural network on these rearranged images, it only achieves 62.9% accuracy, even worse than the regular deep neural network. Note that when we train the regular deep neural network on these rearranged images, its performance is exactly the same, since it never relied on the spatial structure to begin with. And I'm willing to bet that you would struggle to correctly identify the object in more than 70% of these images. That's because your brain is structured to make the same kinds of assumptions about images as the convolutional neural network. So on these rearranged images where there is no spatial structure to exploit, the deep neural network once again achieves superhuman performance. The convolutional neural network was a remarkable breakthrough in the field of machine learning. These models are able to learn to perform image recognition for a wide range of different object categories, matching and sometimes even surpassing human performance. Nowadays, convolutional neural networks are used to automate all sorts of image processing tasks, everything from automatically reading handwritten mail addresses to recognizing your face when you open your phone using Face ID. And usually this success is attributed to the learning ability of deep neural networks. When it comes to learning from huge amounts of data, neural networks do surpass humans. But the fact is, it is simply infeasible to learn from high-dimensional data for both humans and neural networks. The reason humans are able to see is because we have a vast amount of knowledge about how the world works built into the structures of our brain. And these structures are present from birth, we don't need to learn them. And the only reason convolutional neural networks can see is because a human has hard-coded this spatial structure into the architecture before training has even begun. So again, the neural networks don't need to learn from data how the world works.